oh, I feel like a teacher. All this chatter and then suddenly quiet descends. That doesn't happen very often. Good morning. Thanks. Welcome to worship this morning. It is so good to have you here in Bonnyrigg Parish in the warmth of this place, here to worship God. And of course, as every week, we remember those who are still tuning in online. We are delighted to still have the ability to have our services online for people. So if you're tuning in online, we're really glad that you've decided to tune in now. So you'll have seen there are the notices that are on the slides with all the different bits and pieces of information. I have a very exciting notice for you this morning. After church this morning, there's cake. Now, I remember what happened when I just said the word cake last week. There was just a smile on everybody's face. And so rather than just mentioning cake, there is actual real cakes across the road. Cup of tea. It's a really special service this morning as we celebrate communion, as you can see. And we know that communion is a really special time of sharing at God's table. But we also know that the tea and coffee we have over the road after church is a really important time when we share together and we commune with each other then. So we've got communion at the Father's table, and then we've got cake across the road as we celebrate together the new members that are coming to the church this morning. So it's a really, really special morning. Let's still our hearts, let's still our minds, and let's take a moment to pray. Let's pray. Father, thank you for this new day. Father, thank you that as we come here today, we come to be with one another, but we come to be in your presence. Holy Spirit, we pray that you would move among us, that we would sense your peace, your hope, and your comfort. May we each know the deep, deep love of Jesus as we gather today. In his name we pray. Amen. Our opening song is that great reminder of God's presence that's always with us. Let's stand and sing, "Be Still for the Presence of the Lord." Let's once more join together in prayer, and then we'll say the Lord's Prayer, which will be on the screen if you need it. Let us pray. Almighty God, ruler over heaven and earth, Lord of space and time, creator of all that is and was and shall be, Alpha and Omega, we worship you. Receive our praise. Everlasting God, all good, all truth, all love, all mercy, we honor you. Receive our praise. Sovereign God, stronger than we can ever comprehend, greater than we can ever imagine, wiser than we can understand, kinder than we can ever dream. Hear and receive our praise. Gracious God, always helping, always caring, always renewing, always blessing, we thank you. Receive our praise. Living God, with joy and thankfulness, awe and wonder, devotion and dedication, commitment and faith, we acknowledge you. Receive our praise. And let us, as a family united, join in the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples when he said, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory forever. Amen. Okay, now, DJ Club, I wonder who has a good memory? Who's good at remembering things? Are you good at remembering things? I find remembering things quite tricky, if I'm honest. Christina the other day on the bus was remembering, oh, do you remember that waitress in that restaurant we went to called Sasha? I said, how on earth do you remember her name? That's amazing. Sometimes, DJ Club, you're much better at remembering things than grown-ups. So I've got a memory game to do with you this morning. Has anybody collected any of these recently? Have you collected some? We went walking in Dalkeith Country Park and I collected some chestnuts and I was really excited to do so. And do you know what a dog walker passing me said? You're too old to be playing Conkers. Ah, the very cheek. I said, excuse me, I think you'll find you're never too old. To which his wife said, she's right, you know, you're never too old. So I collected some lovely, shiny Conkers. And what I'm going to do, I'm going to hide this under, oh, they're all different colours. Okay, well, we'll need to figure that out. Okay, so I've hidden it under a cup, and you have to try and decide which, where it is. See if you can remember. Do you know where it is? Can you remember? Where do you think? Come on, then, you have a look. Ah, oh, you were right! Well done! It's easy. I need to make it a bit harder. I should have thought this through and had different, not different coloured cups. Ah, right, let's try again. You saw the conker. I know. Let's see if we can make it a bit tricky where you're not sure where it is. I'll confuse you with my skill of speed. Where, DJ, come on, where do you think it is? Oh, man! Oh. Right, one last shot. I'm going to go really fast. Ha! Where do you think it is? Go on, then. Oh, you are you're so good at this. Was that too easy? You're right. Well, you totally were on that, Orla. Well done. Sometimes things can move really fast and we forget where they are and we forget where we've put things and things are happening and we forget. And today in our story in church, we're thinking about remembering to do something really important. And it's remembering to say thank you. Now, I know yous are all really good at saying thank you, but sometimes, if we're really honest, we can forget. We can pray to God and ask for this and ask for that and ask for this and pray for help and pray for our family. And sometimes, if we're honest, we can forget to say thank you. And the story that we're looking at in church reminds us how important it is to say thank you and to remember all the good things that God does for us. And just like you guys were absolutely on it, you knew exactly where those chestnuts were hiding, and you want to make sure that you remember to say thank you to God. And that's what we're going to sing about now as we sing our next song, Thank You God for This Fine Day. Jenny, can I ask you to come out? Jenny, you will know well, she is one of our DJ club leaders. I have known her a little while. We go back. We do have history. And it's been lovely to have Jenny and her whole family coming and being part of Bonnie Rigg Life here. We're grateful for all she gives and all she brings. Sally, can I ask you to come out? Sally was our first ever person applying for our first ever Alpha. And it was so exciting to have somebody who didn't have a church connection here and yet came, did our Alpha, became part of the community here, and we are thrilled to have her and her whole family coming and being part of life here in Bonnie Rigg. Linda and Ronnie's got his tie on this morning, so you know it's a special day. Scrubs up well, I'm telling you, come join us. So, Linda and Ronnie. Ronnie started coming to the church, really, it was on the Wednesday mornings when we opened our doors for prayer. The only thing we could do was open our doors for prayer. And Ronnie came in with his high-vis jacket on, just, you know, very subtly. And then Linda as well, connecting through the online services, came and did an alpha with us and is now many friends here, and we're so grateful for them. Dennis, if you'd like to come up. Dennis is a newbie, so he's very bravely joining, having been just a few times, which is a very brave thing to do, but we are absolutely thrilled. Dennis has a strong history here in Bonnyrigg, has a real heart for Bonnyrigg, is a fellow chaplain of the Roses with me, and we're just really thrilled to have you here. Nicola Tam isn't here this morning, but is somebody who's been part of Bonnyrigg life for a long time. About 10 years she's been connected with the congregation here. And she did our alpha as well, and just came to the point of, I really want to join. I've been here, I've been part of things, but now I want to become a member. And so we're really grateful for Nicola. If I could ask Linda to come out, please. Linda, I think you came on the Wednesday mornings too. So Linda also was part of the prayer time, and all we could do was open our doors to pray. And so having Linda come along, she's previously been at Gore Bridge, lives locally, and is now part of the family here in Bonnyrigg. And Joe, up the back. Joe is another good friend of mine, and we have known each other many years. And she has come back from China, having been teaching English or working in a school over in China for 3 years. She's returned to Scotland. And I have to say, while she was in China, I was sending not very subtle messages of, do you know, Bonnyrigg's really lovely. I think you'll really like it here. There's lovely things. So I was on a mission. So we are just thrilled to have, and she's also transferring our lines to come and be part of the family here. So we are extremely grateful for you, for all that you bring, for all that you are, and we're just open arms in welcoming you into the family here at Bonnyrigg. I have one question, which is, do you, with God's help, promise to give all that you can to the church here in Bonnyrigg? And if you can, please say, I do. So, do you, with God's help, promise to give all that you can to the church family here in Bonnyrigg? Brilliant. Let's pray. Father, thank you. Oh, we're a cheer. Yes, I think a cheer. Always up for some spontaneous applause. Let's pray. Father, thank you so much for the new life that we have in Jesus and for the new life that you're bringing to this church here. Father, we thank you for each person who is joining the church here in Bonnyrigg Parish. We pray that you would use them. We pray that you would bless them, and we thank you that they are a blessing. May each one know your Spirit's anointing. In Jesus' name, amen. Yes, another cheer. Thank you so much. Have a seat. Let's now, as a family, join in our next song together, I, the Lord of Sea and Sky. Well, DJ Club, we have loved having you in with us for this part of the service, but it's now your turn to go over the road. Do not eat all the cake. There better be some left for me. We'll be watching you. But if you want to go across as we continue in our worship. If I can invite Judith to come and to do our reading this morning for us. Thank you.
Reading from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 17, verses 11 to 19. Jesus heals 10 men with leprosy. Now, on his way to Jerusalem, Jesus traveled along the border between Samaria and Galilee. As he was going into a village, 10 men who had leprosy met him. They stood at a distance and called out in a loud voice, "Jesus, Master, have pity on us." When he saw them, he said, "Go, show yourselves to the priests." And as they went, they were cleansed. One of them, when he saw he was healed, came back, praising God in a loud voice. He threw himself at Jesus' feet and thanked him. And he was a Samaritan. Jesus asked, "Were not all 10 cleansed? Where are the other 9? Has no one returned to give praise to God except this foreigner?" Then he said to him, "Rise and go. Your faith has made you well." Amen.
Thank you, Judith, for that great story. And once again, we continue in Luke with another brilliant story. As always this week, time was taken choosing the lectionary reading. There's always a psalm, one from the Old Testament, one from the letters, and one from the Gospel. And seeing as we've been in Luke, we've kind of stuck with Luke the last few weeks. It seemed the obvious choice for today. But if I'm honest, as I read through the passage, I thought, is there really enough to say on Sunday from this passage? It just feels like it's a reminder for us to say thank you. And we kind of covered that in the children's talk. Let's remember to say thank you. It's a really classic, good reminder. But is there more for us in this passage this morning? One of the commentary books that I was reading this week started by introducing this passage by telling a story of an elderly lady in the church who was always moaning and complaining about everything. They then went on to describe young people who didn't know just how lucky their lives were, and they were berating the young generation for constantly complaining and being ungrateful. None of this sat really well with me. Surely there's more to this passage than just a reminder to say thanks. Luke's opening words are a lovely, subtle reminder of the big picture. It says, he said, Jesus is on his way to Jerusalem. The disciples are not off for a jaunt. They're not just having a mosey around. They're on their way to Jerusalem. This is this really subtle reminder that the cross lies ahead on the road. The mission finishes in Jerusalem. All of this is leading to the cross, and Luke doesn't want us to forget that. The passage continues. The disciples find themselves in an in-between place. Sometimes there's details left in the Gospels for a reason, and the geography here really matters. They're in that border region of Galilee and Samaria. Now, border places are often quite vulnerable. I was telling the Guild on Tuesday of a time that I went interrailing round Europe. Sitting on those trains, I passed through many borders, often places of wasteland, less desirable people loitering around. Borders are often not safe. You didn't really want to hang around in a border. You wanted to get straight to the city. And Jesus, here with his disciples, are on the border. Before entering the village, there's this group of 10 men, all kept out of their village due to their leprosy. And they call out to Jesus. Now, there's few examples in Luke where people use Jesus' name. So the fact that they're calling the name of Jesus is really notable. How did they know his name? Had they heard of him? Did they recognize him? But they call out and they ask for help. They ask for compassion. And then we see that beautiful phrase that you find again and again in the Gospels. Jesus saw them. We spoke a couple of weeks ago about how we're called to have Jesus' eyes. We called it love eyes. Once again, we see Jesus with his love eyes looking at these 10 men as they call out. So without completely retelling the story, you heard it read beautifully for us. Jesus tells them to go to the priests. Now, this is not completely left field because the priests were the one who were able to diagnose leprosy. This was all according to the guidelines that were in Leviticus and the Torah. So this was just common practice that people would go to the priests. And I think it's so interesting that when Jesus instructed them to go to the priests, none of them questioned that. Nobody said, "Don't be daft, we can't go to the priests, look at us. We can't go into the village, they'll have a fit, we're not allowed to go near anyone." They were completely compliant to what Jesus instructed them to do. No questions. And we quite often see people questioning Jesus in the Gospels. How can this be? These men just did what he told them without question. And as soon as he started the journey, they are healed. The miracle happens as soon as they obey what Jesus told them to. The line in our story, right in the center, it seems such a small sentence for the enormity of what just happened. "Go show yourselves to the priests." And as they went, they were cleansed. It's a miracle. It's amazing. They were completely restored. It seems so matter of fact, the way that it's put. This mass restoration of 10 men who were completely crippled by their ailments. And this is a multiple healing. They're not just restored physically, they're restored back into society. The stigma around leprosy cannot be underestimated. This healing didn't just have a physical impact. It meant they were welcomed back into life. As they walked back to the village, I wonder what happened. Did they notice each other? Did they say, "Oh, check out, you're looking so much better"? Did they see what was going on? I just can't imagine what their conversations were as they headed to the priests. And yet, one stopped and ran back to Jesus. Their obedience had paid off. I have a postcard in my study that I turn to often. It says, "Proceed as if success is inevitable." Proceed as if success is inevitable. Imagine we faced everything in life assuming that it was going to work out. Assuming that we started the diet, that we'd see it through and we'd lose weight. But this is a plan. This is what's going to happen. Applying for a job, assuming that we're going to get it. Imagine we took on life assuming we were going to succeed. I think being Scottish, sometimes we can lean into our pessimistic nature. Of course we lost at football. We're Scotland. This is what we do. This is how we roam. I wonder if these men had experienced so much disappointment, and yet they were still willing to take the risk, assuming success. I love that they still had hope. I love that they were still willing to obey. And I love the encounter of Jesus and the Samaritan when he returns to him. It's such a visceral experience. He came back praising God in a loud voice and threw himself at the feet of Jesus and thanked him. The Greek word that's used for loud voice is where we get the word megaphone from. So you can just picture him at the top of his voice. Praise God! The absolute ecstasy. He is so thrilled. This man who has, for who knows how long, not been allowed to go near anybody, throws himself at the feet of Jesus. Now, having come through a pandemic, we all know what it's like to be keeping a distance from people, to be told we can't touch our nearest and dearest. Yesterday, I met with a friend who I've not seen since pre-pandemic. And when I met her, let me tell you, that was a big hug. Oh, it's so good to see you. That embrace felt extra special because we'd not been near each other for such a long time. This man throws himself at Jesus' feet, overwhelmed with gratitude. Here's a man not touched by another person, whose only companions were Jews who most likely despised him. And here he is, restored, healed. How could he be anything but grateful? I noticed what Jesus said. Your faith has made you well. Wasn't it interesting that Jesus said that? Last week we were talking about the faith of a mustard seed and reminding each other that actually it's not our faith, it's the miracle God that we trust in. And yet here it seems that this man's faith has actually made a difference. He's affirming the Samaritan's faith. All 10 men were healed. Yet there is something of the response of gratitude in this man that made him different. Something of his reaction that made a difference, that his faith was built. Now, I am an absolute firm believer in the power of gratitude. I don't think it's just a good thing to be grateful. This isn't about being polite. It's not about good manners. Gratitude is an absolute power tool that each and every single one of us can use. Gratitude is so powerful. I think it's like a secret weapon that the world forgot that we've got. It can hugely change our day. If I'm sleeping, I'll wake up and then, you know, those nighttime thoughts you get when you wake in the night and you just start worrying about things. It's dark. Everything seems so out of proportion. And if you wake up and you begin to think, oh, what am I going to do? And how am I going to manage this? And what are we going to do about that? And those thoughts begin to come, those nighttime hours when you wake up. Oh, they can be brutal. I've worked really hard at training myself in those nighttime thoughts start coming. I just think of the things I'm grateful for. I thank God for what's happened in the previous day. I thank God for the different gifts that he's given. And if we are able to, we can begin to train ourselves like a muscle that gets stronger. If we choose gratitude, it can completely transform what we think, the way we think. Gratitude is something that philosophers and religious people have been thinking about and studying. But it's only in the 1950s that proper research started going into the subject. You will all, I'm sure, be familiar with the phrase, count your blessings. It's quite an old phrase. It's quite simple. And yet, it's really powerful. Count your blessings. It's going to change how you think about things. Here we see a story where Jesus miraculously healed 10 men. 9 of them didn't come back. Now, it could have been they got caught up with going to the priest and the ceremonial practices that took place there. But the Samaritan didn't worry about protocol and didn't worry about procedures or ceremonies. He bolted back to Jesus, fell at his feet, and said thanks. In these days, you will know as well as I do, we have a steady flow of negativity. Sometimes it can feel really overpowering. And yet, we have much to be thankful for. We're hearing of the constant decline of the church, the constant pressures of that. And yet today we celebrated 6 new members. We have much to be grateful for. Let's choose to be like that Samaritan. Once again, Luke comes in with a killer line. The Samaritan, the one that you least expect, he's the one that's the example. The Good Samaritan was just a story that Jesus told that had people reeling with the shock of it. What? The Samaritan? That's who we're meant to be like. What? And here we see an actual example where the Samaritan is who we want to be like. Isn't it amazing how Jesus turns everything? Let's choose to be like the Samaritan. Let's be people who are grateful. Let's get our megaphones out and start praising God full volume. We have much to be thankful for, even in our pain, even in our sorrow, even in our struggles. Yes, they're real. But let's choose to be people who are grateful, and let's throw ourselves at the feet of Jesus. Let's pray. Father, thanks again for your word, for the truth, for the treasures that are within it. And Father, we thank you for this story. We thank you for the example the Samaritan is to us. Father, we pray that we would know your healing touch in areas of pain. Father, we pray that we would know your restoration in our isolation. And Father, we pray that you would help us to be people who use your gratitude for all that you've done for us. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's once more together join in song as we sing our pre-communion hymn, When I Survey the Wondrous Cross. Please be seated. This is the Lord's table. The Lord invites us to share the feast. Jesus said, "I am the bread of life. Whoever believes in me will never be thirsty." I wonder your memories of communion. As I got ready this morning, I thought I'm going to put on my brightest dress possible. Growing up, when it was Communion Sunday, everybody was in black. I went to a church in London where they still wore top hats and tails for communion. It's this mad cultural shift of wow. And it is a time of somberness. It's a somber song we sang as we reflect on Jesus' sacrifice. And yet it's a celebration. It is a party as we think of the victory of the cross, as we think of all that Jesus has conquered. We come with joy and with celebration. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ be with us all. Let's pray. Out of the fullness of your gifts, O God, we make our offerings to you. We present this bread and this wine at your table, for all things come from you. Blessed be your holy name forever, through Jesus our Lord. Amen. The tradition which I handed on to you came from the Lord himself, that on the night he was arrested, the Lord Jesus took bread and, after giving thanks to God, broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, he took the cup and said, "This is the new covenant sealed by my blood. Whenever you drink it, do in memory of me." For every time you eat this bread or drink this cup, you proclaim the death of Jesus until he comes again. As the Lord Jesus took bread, we take these elements of bread and wine, set apart from all common use, to this holy use and mystery. And as he gave thanks and blessed, let us draw near to God with our prayers of thanksgiving. Let us pray. God, let us be like the Samaritan in our thanks and our gratitude, completely wholehearted. It's our calling and our joy at all times and all places to give thanks and praise. Holy, heavenly King, eternal God, by the life of your Spirit, you fill the hearts of the faithful. By the light of your word, you give us strength and love. Holy, 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 God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Amen. We will now distribute the elements. Please take a cup with the bread and a cup with the wine, which is juice. Hold it or place it in the pew in front of you. And we will all, when everything's distributed, we will all take communion at the same time together.
Thank you.
taste and see that God is good. Happy are those who find refuge in him. Take, eat. This is the body of Christ, which is broken for you. Do so in remembrance of him. This is the cup of the new covenant. Drink of it, all of you. Let us pray. Glorious God, we thank you for the love which brings us food from heaven, the life of your dear Son, which assures us that we belong to the company of the faithful. Grant that we may be strengthened by this fellowship and by the Holy Spirit, that we may continue the work of Jesus in the world. And may the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with us all. Amen. Let us sing that communion hymn that we sing each time. Lift up ye gates. Please be seated. Ha, that was great. Ha, brilliant. Let's once more turn to the Father in prayer as we pray for others. Father, we pray for this world. So much is broken. So much is hurting. So much needs your touch. Father, we pray for hope where there is despair. We pray for peace where there is conflict. We pray for your bounteous provision where there is poverty. We pray for your light to shine in the darkness. And Father, we pray for your church. We thank you for the family here in Bonnyrigg where you have called us. We thank you for this fellowship. We thank you for the denomination that we're part of. But we thank you that you are so beyond denominations that we are part of the great company of the church, past, present, and future, completely united and one in faith. We pray for one another. We pray for those who have been part of this fellowship and have moved away. We pray for those who are unable to come, confined to their homes through age and infirmity. We pray for those who are unwell. We pray for those who have become disillusioned, for those who have lost their faith. We pray for the churches of this town, striving through word and deed to make known the love of Jesus in this community. We think especially of those in positions of leadership and oversight. We ask that you give them the faith and the wisdom that they need. We pray also for those in their charge, that they will respond gladly to the opportunities for service, making vision reality. We pray for the wider family of the church, for those seeking to work out their faith in their own situations. We think especially of those who are persecuted for their beliefs, for those whom commitment to Christ is dangerous and costly. Grant them courage and adversity. Help them to stand for their convictions against all odds. Father, we pray for the unity of your church, for the breaking down of barriers, for further growing together. We pray for the witness of your people everywhere, that through their life and service, your love will be made known, your word proclaimed, and your kingdom brought closer. We pray this in the powerful name of Jesus. Amen. Let us finish our time this morning together by singing once more, In Christ Alone. stand. Here in the power of Christ we stand, and in the power of Christ we leave, knowing the love of Jesus, filling our hearts, lighting our way. And may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Can I quickly remind you to come on through for tea and cake, come and get to know